Thank you. morning. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb, be blessing and honor and glory and power forever. Would you sing with us, to him who sits on the throne? To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Sing with us. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Oh, be blessing and glory and honor and power forever.
Thank you.
more time.
Much richer, full. A simple thank you just isn't enough. A simple thank you doesn't convey how we truly feel. You deserve more. We know you saw horrible things. We know you sacrificed so much. And we may never completely understand what you went through. But we are grateful. So grateful. Today, we don't have much to offer you. We can't even begin to repay the debt we owe for your service to our country. But today, there is one thing we can promise to do. We promise to remember your sacrifice. We promise to remember your courage. We promise to never forget what you fought for. And we promise to always value our freedom.
Would you stand again this morning, please?
Please be seated. This past week, our nation observed Veterans Day. It's our privilege today to recognize those of our congregation and those in attendance who have served our nation, who have served us, and sacrificed for us, that we might have the freedoms we have today. A lot is being said today in our political picture. Good things, but mostly bad. And I know that there's one king. He's on the throne in heaven. He's in control. But we have been privileged to live in a nation that has afforded us the privilege and freedom to come and worship like we are today. We're going to focus on the persecuted church today and how so many of our brothers and sisters in Christ don't have the freedom we have today. They are being persecuted because of what we're doing right now. And we're doing what we are doing right now because God has given us those freedoms. But men and women have fought to keep those freedoms. And we can never forget what they have done. I'm going to ask those who have served, who are veterans of our country, our armed forces, if you would please stand that we may recognize you this morning. Thank you for their service. Lord, we pray for all of our armed forces today, wherever they are. We pray for their protection. We pray for their encouragement. We pray for their support. We pray today that you would be with those who give direction to them from the Pentagon, from the White House, from Congress. Lord, we pray for those in authority who make decisions that do affect the way we live. We know that decisions can be made that could cause there to be military responses around the world, and today we just pray for all of those who are serving and those who have served. We pray today that you would be with us gathered here. Help us, Father, that we would never minimize what those have served, those who have served have given. We'd never cease to thank them, to honor them. We pray today for your church, the body of Christ. Some gathered here in this place, others gathered around this city, around our county and our nation, and literally around the world. Our brothers and sisters are gathered to worship you. We pray for every believer today. We pray for the work of the gospel that it goes forth through the efforts of the national churches and our missionaries who help, who are there to give direction and guidance when needed, and opening up new works where the gospel can be taken. We pray for many who are being persecuted for their faith. We pray for the country of Cameroon today, as the Book of Quran thing spills over into that country, and it's a lot of problems that come from that. And we just pray for them today. We pray for the church that you said that you would build, and the gates of hell would not prevail against it. Help the church in America not to take for granted the things we have, and help us to do what you would have us to do, that your kingdom would go forth. We pray for needs that are represented here by this congregation. And Lord, you know them all. We continue to lift up Gary to you, as he will be facing surgery. Please be with him and Rose today. We pray for Kathy. She would continue to give her strength, both physically and emotionally, to be strong in her diagnosis. We pray for Carol and Rod today, that you would be with them, continue to minister to their body's needs. For Liz, continue to be with her. And for the many others on our prayer list, Father, you know who they are. And we pray that you would minister to their needs today. We thank you that you have given us this instructions in Scripture to come boldly before the throne of grace, to come with confidence, knowing that if we ask anything in your name, you hear us, and if you hear us, you grant us the petitions we ask of you. Father, we thank you that this is not an opinion. These are not words of people, but this is your plan. This is the way you work, and you allow us to come before you. And so we do that this morning. We thank you for hearing us, and in faith believing, we trust you for the results. And we ask this in Jesus' name. And all those who agree with this prayer, say with me, amen. We want to welcome you to the Church of Genesis today, and trust that you are already experiencing the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. That's why we're here, isn't it? We're not here just to sing and see each other, but we're here to worship the Lord, amen? And so as we're here together today, we welcome you, and we just want to mention a couple things. You have a pink sheet in your bulletin, which is the registration form for the Christmas dinner coming up in December. It seems like it's a far way off, but it's not. We do have to get our reservations in, so please do that. All the information is there for you, and I believe that that will be adequate for you to know what's going on. Also, next Sunday is collection day for the Christmas child boxes. I know many of you have brought them already. It's a beautiful sight, isn't it, to see these up here as we prepare for that. And there are more coming. And so if you haven't brought yours back yet, please bring it next Sunday, and so we can have a good send-off, pray over them, and send them to children around the world we've been talking about for the past several weeks. If you have any questions today about anything with the boxes, Melinda is here. She's our coordinator. And Dave's back at the table. We need more boxes. We have some. So if you have any questions, please see Dave and Melinda. They'll be glad to help you. I believe these are all announcements we need to make that mention of this morning. We're going to ask the ushers to wait upon us for our morning offering. Let us pray. Father, thank you for your provision. You bless us so much with the needs we have. And so we ask you to receive back from us the offering we give to you, which we believe belongs to you, in return for your goodness. And so we ask you to bless each gift and bless each giver alike, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Privilege to have her come and share with us on that day. I'm not even sure how many years now that was. Five. Okay, thank you. You keep track. A school teacher keeps track of those things. But we are blessed because she didn't only come that one day, but she became a part of us. And we have a resident representative that advocates for the persecuted church. It's opened my eyes. It's increased my concern and developed in me a desire to not forget those of our brothers and sisters who are suffering. And last Sunday was the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church. Diane and Tim were recovering from COVID, and we kind of pushed it back another week to give them a chance to recover. And so we're observing that day of prayer today, and she has put together a presentation involving some others from the church, and we're going to just turn the service over to her for a few moments as they share about the day of prayer this year. So, to the committee.
My name is Anwar. I live in Syria. When my family found out that I had opened my heart to Jesus, they were distraught. One day, my sister called me crying. She told me that I had caused pain for my brothers and sisters and my parents. She also said that our mother was so upset that she had to go to the hospital. I had been living with my brother, so I went to see him. He He told me that I could no longer enter his home and put all my belongings outside in front of the house. I was devastated and kept asking myself, why? Why did this happen to me? The only reason is that I am a Christian now. I had to hide this decision, but they did find out. I had nowhere to go. I heard that Open Doors had a place called the Center of Hope. I went there. They helped me to get a job and a place to live. I am now teaching English at the center, and also I'm helping young Christians on their spiritual journey. I want everyone to know that Jesus is everything to me. When I had no one, he was with me, my brother, my companion, my best friend.
This is a picture of Miriam. I'm going to be portraying her in the following narrative. My name is Miriam Ibrahim. I am from Sudan. My mother was a Christian, but my father was Muslim. Therefore, the Sudanese government considered me Muslim. I married a Christian Sudanese American man and refused to revoke my belief in Jesus Christ. My half-brothers reported me to the authorities, and my siblings refused to recognize my marriage. They said it was invalid, and they said my baby was illegitimate. I was arrested and thrown in prison and chained like an animal. They even chained my baby, my nine-month-old baby, little chain. He could only move it so far. I refused to even teach him to talk during this time because the language there was so horrible. I was sentenced to 100 lashes and death by hanging. But before my sentence could be carried out, they found out I was pregnant, so they decided to stay my execution until the baby was born. Well, I went into labor and the midwife asked, could I be unchained to deliver the baby? They said no. And my little girl was born malnourished. Well, my story, my plight gained international notice. A lot of organizations wanted to advocate for me, and because of all the international pressure, my sentence, my conviction was revoked. I was given asylum in Italy, and later I came to the United States. As a Christian, I know the freedom I have in Christ. No one can take away your right to pray or to worship. No government, no laws, no authorities can ever take that from you. Miraculously, my children are doing well. But I suffer a few health problems, probably due to the time I was in prison. But praise God, we are alive.
My name is Youssef. I live in Egypt. One evening, a masked man with a gun entered my uncle's store. He kidnapped my uncle. Outside the store, there were more armed men dressed in black waiting for the gunman as he dragged my uncle to the truck. I approached the men thinking that they were the police. They asked to see my ID card. When they saw my card, they realized that I was a Christian. They asked me about the store owner who was in the truck. They wanted to know if I were related to him. I told them that he was my uncle. That's when they pointed a gun at me and put me in the back of the truck with my uncle. While we were in the truck, they pointed their weapons at us and said if either of us spoke, they would kill us. I was blindfolded for 13 days. I had to constantly endure insults. During those terrifying days, the only voice I heard were those of my captors. Every day was a nightmare. I couldn't distinguish day from night. They insulted me continuously and treated me very badly. Plus, I was far from family. I missed my children so much. I was never allowed to contact my family. What kept me going through this terrifying captivity? Prayer was my comfort. When I prayed, the Lord brought certain scriptures to my mind. The Word of God gave me assurance in my darkest hour. I meditated on these verses from Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Fortunately, I was released, but I have a cousin who was kidnapped, and as of today, he has not been released. At this time, we're going to see a video about Egypt.
The message of the persecuted church is not an easy message to deliver anytime for any of us. And I have worked with being a volunteer for 11 years, and I never find it easy. When I used to be a volunteer with another organization, we were required to make many contacts. And when I called Pastor Ead, he was so nice on the phone. I mean, I wasn't used to that. I was used to saying, no, we're not interested, and, you know, many other excuses. But he was so genuine on the phone, and I thought, this man is really genuine. It's not because I had his kids in class. And I really appreciate his heart, because we are blessed with a pastor and a wife who not only have cared deeply about all of us, but Pastor has challenged us to care, not only for us as a body of Christ, but our community, our nation, and the world and the persecuted church. And that is a rare quality. Brother Andrew was the founder of Open Doors. And he, back in the Cold War, took Bibles to the closed churches. And he wanted to establish an organization, which he did. And these are the verses that he founded it on, and Pastor read one. Behold, I have put before you an open door, which no man can shut. And Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. But why is persecution so intense today? We've always had Christian persecution, but it's most intense today. Why? Because so many people are coming to Christ that the governments of the world, who are have the spirit of the enemy, do not want Christians to flourish. But even with all the pressure upon all the Christians of the world, they're coming to Jesus. I didn't get this in time to the guys, but I'm going to hold this up. You're not going to see the countries, but look at the colors on the map, and look at how many colors, the colors of orange and, yeah, the oranges and the kind of orange, dark orange. Look how many countries are under persecution. These are heavily persecuted countries. I want to give you an idea of what's happening in the world, because guess what? Fox and CNN and all MSNBC and all these stations really don't tell us much about what's happening in all these countries in the world. Let's look at India. In India, the religious leaders are calling for all Christians to be beheaded. There are also nationalistic groups who have like parades and, you know, kind of rallies, and they're telling the people to take their shoes and beat Christians. During COVID, they were denied food and medical help because they were Christians. Afghanistan has been in the news, right? They are killing Christians in Afghanistan because they have a list. And they go house to house to look for the Christians, and they're killed. Excuse me. The Taliban wants to eliminate all the Christians. And women, those of us who are women, can really feel for this. They drag them from their homes or wherever, and they're forced into brutal marriages where they're brutalized, and they have no choice in the matter. And many of them will never see their families again. And some of these girls are very young. Those of you who are parents, can you imagine that, losing your daughter? And sons, they take these young boys and they force them to join the Taliban. One believer stated, the only one left to protect us is Emmanuel, God with us. Open Doors and other organizations are helping these Afghanis, but their privacy, for the protection, they cannot tell us information. How about China? You know, we all know China's crippled the world. The government is constantly stopping religious freedom. There is an app, a Bible app, that was very popular in China. They closed it down. For those in China who are Muslim, they closed down the Quran. And also any social media or Christian organizations or Christian things that they could find, they're all shut down. Because they're a threat. How many of you heard about the missionaries who were captured in Haiti? Anybody? Okay. How many of you, any of you been to Holmes County in Ohio? Some of you are familiar with Holmes County, the Amish Mennonite area of Ohio. Well, right outside of Berlin, there's a small office of Christian Aid Ministries. It's a very small, very simple office. And they're keeping people abreast of what's happening. Those of you who don't know, there are 16 Americans and one Canadian who are kidnapped. They want $1 million per person. And the missionary organization and the government are trying to get their release. But can you imagine how difficult it's going to be? It is. This is, I think, day 30 for them. The kidnappers belong to a powerful, notorious gang, and they want the money so that they can become more powerful. And what better way to get money quick? To get ransom. The Washington Post said that one of the missionaries early on got a message out, and I'm going to quote, "Please pray, pray, pray. We don't know where they're taking us." And since then, there has been no communication from them. I listened to the updates from the organization, and one of the kidnapped people that are kidnapped had a saying on his desk, and this is what he said: "God created you for ministry. If you are not serving, you are just existing, and God wants to use you to make a difference in this world." How many of you in here have children? How many of you have children? The majority of you have children. Do you realize how children are persecuted? They're harassed and bullied by classmates and friends. They have to endure seeing their parents attacked, suffer, and sometimes they're there when their parents are killed. They lack food and medical attention and other basic necessities because of their faith. Some of them become orphans because their parents are killed or their parents receive such long sentences they don't see them. And some children, this is really hard to say, are brutally killed for their faith. There's one story that has stuck with me over the years. A young boy was with his family in their house, and terrorists came in, and they grabbed the boy, and of course they're not treating him gently, and they probably have a knife to his neck, and they said to the father, "Deny your faith, or this kid dies, this child will die." And the child is crying out to his dad, "Daddy, don't denounce your faith. Even if I die, don't denounce your faith." And he kept crying it out. I believe at the end they did let the little boy go, but can you imagine? If you were a parent, how hard it would be to know that you could stop the killing of your child in front of your eyes. Leah from Nigeria was captured by the Boko Haram at 15. There were 100 girls taken. Excuse me, I stopped reminiscing from COVID. The 100 were taken, and they told the girls they, you know, they would be released if they said these verses from the Quran. These girls all said it, but Leah. And these girls waved goodbye to Leah, and she was left with the Boko Haram. Well, this has been since 2018, and the last that I heard, she was still alive, forced into marriage, and we don't know if she'll ever get away, and her parents cry for her every day and pray. But Leah watched all those schoolmates go. She could have been set free if she only would have recanted her Christianity. Do you think that takes bravery? Do you think that takes courage? It takes a commitment to Jesus that most of us have no clue. What can we learn from our brothers and sisters? What can we learn from them? They are faithful despite the pain and the suffering they experience. They are faithful in sharing their faith. No matter how difficult it is, they are able to forgive their captors. This story also has stayed with me over the years. An ISIS fighter called a missionary, and he said, come and speak to me and tell me all about this Christianity. So the missionary went. He had his Bible, and he explained many things about Christianity. The ISIS fighter said, well, now you're going to die. And the missionary knew in advance that he was taking his life in his hands by going to see an ISIS fighter. So the ISIS fighter killed him. But before he did, the missionary said, here's my Bible, please read it. And then he was killed. Later on, the ISIS fighter did read the Word of God, and guess what? He was saved, and he went on to become an evangelist to these other ISIS fighters. So, is a life wasted? Never. Open Doors is a small organization. They sent a lot of materials. I'd appreciate it if you would take them because I don't want them to go to waste. And there is a pamphlet called Prayer Alert. And each day there's about a sentence prayer that you could pray for someone in a persecuted church. It would be wonderful if you took them. It's an easy way. How many of you remember the story of Jim Elliot? Do you remember Jim Elliot that was killed in Ecuador back in 1956? We're going back a ways. Anybody remember? Some of you do. Jim and four other missionaries were in the jungles of Ecuador to work with a very savage tribe called the Alca Indians. They were young men, they had wives, and they had little children. And they were going to arrange to try to really make contact with them. And they had guns. The Americans had guns. But they made a pact that if the Alca Indians attacked, they would not kill them because they knew the gospel message would never go forth. So the Aka speared them in their river, and they never shot their guns. They willingly died. Jim Elliot penned this sometime before he died. He said, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain that which he cannot lose. Because of their death, many young men and women went to the mission field, and the Aka tribe, many became Christians, including the man who speared Jim Elliot. And lastly, there is a song. I don't know if any of you remember Steve Green had this song, Find Us Faithful. And I just would like to read the one stanza. It says, oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe. And the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. Most of us have lived 50 years in here. Maybe some less, maybe some more. But the most important thing in our lives is, are we faithful?
Thank you, Diane, and those who share this morning for bringing it real to us. I'm going to ask if we would just stand for a moment in proxy for the persecuted church, and let's go to prayer for them, shall we? Father God, forgive us when we are complacent about our faith. Forgive us when we take for granted what we have. Forgive us when we treat lightly the calling that you have in our lives to serve you. Remind us today of those brothers and sisters around the world who suffer for the cause of Christ. Thank you for reminding us today of these specific situations that were shared. And I pray today for hope, encouragement, safety, and most importantly, I pray today that their faith would be strong and that you would strengthen our faith to be like that. Speak to all of us, we pray. Bless our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. In Revelation chapter 7, we have an account of a vision of the Apostle John. And it goes like this. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they, and where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger, never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Christian persecution has been around for a long time. The Apostle Paul himself was a persecutor of Christians. Stephen was the first Christian martyr. The writer of the Hebrews documented a pattern of persecution where he writes, "Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground." Throughout history and in our current day, as Diane shared, persecution is increasing because of the anti-Christian approach of so many people in our world today. And it's going to continue until the end of time as we know it. The scripture text from Revelation describes something that will occur in heaven in the future. Inasmuch as we have not personally experienced what those we have mentioned, I would emphasize the words of the Hebrew author, "The world was not worthy of them." As we observe the scene from John's Revelation in the throne room of heaven, we may conclude two main thoughts. Now, quickly, I want to just share two things this morning. There was a great multitude that no one could count. And this multitude came from every tribe, nation, people, and language. It was comprised of a universal collective of people who had like experiences. People who came through tribulation, who suffered for their faith. They were standing before the throne and before the Lord. Try, if you will, to envision the mass of people, too numerous to count, actively present before the Lord. They were wearing white robes and holding palm branches. They came from a posture of righteous victory as they were celebrating before the throne. They cried out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." You may remember a similar type of declaration on the triumphal entry, when people were shouting, "Hosanna," or "Salvation belongs to God." The accompanying angels were also standing around the throne, as we read from that portion of scripture today. They fell down on their faces and worshiped God. The atmosphere is purely adoration and worship, and they attributed worth to God. In verse 12, there are seven characteristics of this worship that were ascribed to God, and it denotes the all-embracing character of God. Let me remind you of them in verse 12. He said, "Amen, praise, glory, wisdom, thanks, and honor, and power, and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." These attributes attributed to God because of who he is. There was a great multitude that no one could number. And then we also find, as the man asked the revelator, "Who are these?" And he said, "Sir, you know. These are they who have come out of the great tribulation." Now, there are varying views on what is meant by the great tribulation, whether it refers to the 7-year period at the end of the age, or if it has a more general meaning of great or immense tribulation through the ages. But it does seem to refer to those who have been martyred for their faith. The scripture we read this morning says that they have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. They gave their blood because Jesus gave his. People that we will never know personally, people that we pray for today, people who are being persecuted for their faith. And as we have seen with the rise of ISIS in the past and perhaps in the future, these things will happen where people are claiming the name of Christ and giving their blood because Jesus gave his. They gave their lives. Their focus around the throne was selflessly on the Lamb. I wonder what our focus would be if we endured what these have endured. They were not questioning why as they stood before the throne. They were not complaining. They did not ask God to explain what happened to them and why it had to happen. But they gave all of their attention to the Lamb. And the Bible tells us that they received their reward. It says that they will never suffer again. And as I look at what the writer to the Hebrews had accounted from those who in his day suffered because of their faith in Christ, things that you and I can only imagine and try to imagine because we have never had to suffer that way. The writer here, as John records this revelation, says they will never hunger, they will never thirst, they will not be subject to the beating sun or the scorching heat, but the Lamb will be their shepherd. He will lead them to living water. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. We don't know. You and I have no idea. We cannot predict what we might have to experience between now and the time that Jesus Christ comes back. Oh, we pray that it's not serious. We hope we don't have to be persecuted the way that we've heard about this morning. We hope that we continue to have the freedom of worship that we have in our nation today, but we have no guarantees. We have no idea what may happen. But the Lamb is our shepherd, and He will lead us. He will wipe away every tear from our eyes. These that we refer to today are they who have come out of the great tribulation. I don't believe I'm doing any disservice to the integrity of the scripture text when I say that I believe among them in that vision will be people that Diane shared about, and those who others who shared today, and those we pray for, and those we read about in the news. All of these, some of them I believe will be standing in that throng of people, and the world is not worthy of them. What our fellow believers experience today in countries of persecution for practicing their faith in ways that we take for granted is beyond our ability to fully comprehend. They deserve our respect. They deserve our support. They deserve us to be prayers for them. These are they who have come out of great tribulation. They have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. They have gone through much sorrow into great jubilation. They're redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Let's pray. Father, we again thank you today for focusing our attention on this group of people. People that you love, people that are a part of the same body of Christ as we, those who are a part of this church that we belong to. Father, I pray for them, but I also pray for us, because we are so apt to forget. We're so apt to take things for granted. We're so apt to think that it's over there, not here. God, help us. Help us to have the concern of your heart for these that we pray for today. I ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Give up all the death. Thank you.